talking about brown and black.
Right.
Because brown and black are the ones that's filling up the penitentiary. And if we look at economics, it only costs $40,000 to incarcerate a male.
For?
Just a year. It's $40,000 per person in incarcerated male. But we don't have universal child care. And so we'll spend $21 million to run somebody for governor of Alabama. We'll raise $21 million, but yet we still got schools like in the DMV in Baltimore that don't have heat. And don't have air conditioning in the summer.
We can spend $41,000 to incarcerate a black man, but it's hard for a black man to find a job even paying $40,000.
And especially after they've been in the penitentiary. So, you know, they got the 12th Amendment or 13th Amendment, I forget what the name of it, but they talk about how we have more black men incarcerated than we had in slavery. Mm-hmm. So the new slavery is for brown and black is the penitentiary, because mm-hmm. that's becoming a revenue stream for itself. And then we look at privatized prisons. We look at, there's an organization called Corrections Corporation of America, and they're traded on the New York Stock Exchange, and they build prisons. So how can we, as, yes, it's true, Google it. They build prisons and they're trading on the New York Stock Exchange, CCA. They are privatized prisons. So we put it on a profit share. So, and we all know about, we as black people, we have to understand that. And so there's been, whether we look at it as house Negroes or field Negroes, that separation after integration has become more prevalent because of the fact the ones of us who could access white universities or whatever, we did, but we didn't go back. Integration was like, if I go to China, they teach me Chinese food, I come back and teach my people Chinese food, and if I learn soul food, I go to China and teach them soul food.
Or like the visas are for those coming from China or Africa. They get here, they get 4 to 6 years to study, 2 years to work,
and
to
they
learn.
Go
then
back.
They have to go back. It's required.
And then they give back to their community and they teach others what they learned. Mm. Well, we in the black community, all we did was we did the same thing that the white man did to Africa to make their journey. They took the strongest, the best, but instead of us going back, we made white folks more money. We made white communities better. But the masses of our people, we did not help. Now we have a system in place where we have the institutionalized and the non-institutionalized. And if you look at like educational programs, education has always been the equal thing that made us all relevant. Because once you get educated, you want more for yourself, you love yourself. But we now have people who are institutionalized. They come in and out of the revolving doors of the penitentiary because that has become a system, and now that they're producing GDP. Like they're creating revenue from paying people $1 an hour, 15 cents an hour. And now they're selling that product in exchange. So these people are now, they want you to come back because they're making too much money off of it.
Right. So what would you say, especially being here in DC, what would you say is what's ailing young people here? You said you're in a lot of the schools and stuff. What do you think is ailing young people?
Well, I mean, it's true, and I have to say it too. We had like a community, we had the church. You know, I was raised by Miss Lucy up the street, Miss Lily. I tried to steal some from the store, Miss Lily whooped my butt, then sent me to my mom. So whenever I saw Miss Lily, I would be on point because she was a village. And I had to respect her. And then I went to church every day, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So beyond anything, I always had a higher power than myself. Well, some things I just wasn't gonna do because I had a mother that stayed in my butt. And then I had a grandmother that stayed in my butt. I had the neighbor who stayed in my butt. So I felt good about myself. Metropolitan Baptist Church embraced me. Well, now.
Pause real quick. Even if I hear you mention all these people, I don't hear you mention a male at all.
Well, I had a dad. He was an alcoholic.
Okay.
But he died when I was like, he died when I was 15.
Okay.
But see, that's another thing about me too. This is where I'm at too. That's an excuse. Meaning like, okay, I did come up poor. My mother was a single mother with two kids. That's her story, that ain't my story. That's an excuse. You know, we can't let you grew up in the hood, you grew up in Flint, Michigan. That's their story. That ain't my story. I design and architect my own life. You can't let your trauma, your oppressor become your identity. I do a lot of work with rehab people, and they'll say, well, I'm a crackhead because my daddy molested me from 4 to 9. And now they're 40 years old. I'm like, well, baby, what did you do from 9 to 40? So one four-year period in your life controls your oppressor has become your identity. And especially a sign of poverty is always blaming somebody else for my issues instead of being responsible for myself and being self-actualized, meaning that everybody got to pull their own weight. And not saying, it's a sign of poverty. I don't care what anybody says. You go to any penitentiary, any rehab center, any poor people, they always say, the white man won't give me a job. The man won't give me the job. The white man bringing the drugs in my community. And I said, but bruh, I don't see no white people selling the drugs. You the one creating the poison in the community. So you got to look at the man in the mirror. What are you doing to make a difference? And then, you know, you go to the penitentiary, then you want me to feel sorry for you. You sold the drugs.